Welcome everybody to episode 7 of From the Vault. Don't forget to like this video and comment in the comment section below. Subscribe if you haven't already, and thanks to those who have already subscribed. The poll is open for episode 8. The Twitter link is in the comment section below. Now, that episode will be the first From the Vault of 2018, meaning this episode, episode 7, will be the last From the Vault of 2017. My year-end video will not be a From the Vault, but to start preparation for the 25th anniversary of Monday Night Raw, I'm going to be doing a top 25 list. The top 25 greatest title wins in Raw history. So look out for that video in the near future. As for From the Vault Episode 7, this was the runner-up to Heroes of Wrestling that was Episode 6. And since this was runner-up by one vote, I decided to make this topic Episode 7. So here it is, From the Vault ECW December to Dismember. In the summer of 2003, WWE bought the assets of ECW in bankruptcy court, which meant they had the ECW tape library and they had the copyright rights to ECW and could use them as they saw fit. And after the successes of the Rise and Fall of ECW DVD and the first one-night stand pay-per-view, The Reunion Show, there was a huge interest in ECW once again. Now, with that, WWE decided to make ECW into a third brand, with a second one-night stand pay-per-view to happen as a launch of the new brand. And you also had the WWE versus ECW special prior to the second one-night stand. And the second one-night stand was to take place on June 11th, 2006, with the premiere of ECW on Sci-Fi to take place the following Tuesday. And on the second one-night stand, you had Rob Van Dam defeating John Cena to become the new WWE Champion. And on the first episode of ECW on Sci-Fi, Rob Van Dam was awarded the ECW World Championship. And everything was going good. Everyone was optimistic. And then Rob Van Dam was, no pun intended, at the highest point in his professional wrestling career. I mean, he was finally the world champion. He was the world champion of the top promotion on the planet. He was the WWE champion, and yeah, it was the third brand. It wasn't the real ECW, but still, he was the ECW champion as well. He was WWE champion. He was ECW champion, a double world champion. Everything couldn't be greater. There was optimism for this new brand. Rob Van Dam's finally in the main event scene. He's finally the world champion. Everything couldn't be greater. And then, 3 weeks later,
bad boys, bad boys, whatcha gonna do? Whatcha gonna do when they come for you? Bad boys, bad boys, whatcha gonna do? Whatcha gonna do when they come for you?
After a house show in Huntington, West Virginia, on July 2nd, Rob Van Dam was pulled over for speeding on U.S. Route 52 in Hanging Rock, Ohio. However, he was pulled over for speeding. Now, usually, you could get a ticket, you could get a warning. He who has never sped raised their hand. And those who did, you're going to hell for lying, because, let's face it, we've all sped before a time or two. It's whether you've been caught or not. Now, Rob Van Dam was pulled over for speeding. However, a simple being pulled over for speeding turned into a drug arrest, because Rob Van Dam, he was in possession of 18 grams of marijuana and 5 Vicodin pills. Sabu was in the passenger seat. He was in possession of some shit as well. Now, drug-related arrests, according to WWE's wellness policy, can lead to immediate termination. Now, Rob Van Dam wasn't terminated, but he did have to serve a 30-day suspension, but after he worked ECW and Raw to drop both the WWE and ECW championships. Now, in terms of mistakes by a world champion as he's world champion, this might be the dumbest. Now, I'm not knocking his lifestyle or him speeding. Again, he who has never sped raised their hand, and those who did, you're going to hell for lying. Now, again, we all live our lives the way we choose to, but if you're gonna speed and you get caught, don't have illegal shit on you, because I'm a Rob Van Dam fan. But Rob screwed Rob here. This is why, spoiler alert, Vince didn't want to put the belt back on him at December to Dismember or ever again. This arrest was basically the end of Rob Van Dam's WWE run. After his arrest and before he would have to serve his 30-day suspension, Rob Van Dam had to drop the ECW Championship, and he dropped it to the Big Show. Now, while Big Show wouldn't have been my first choice and not the first choice of pretty much everybody, I mean, you look at his run as ECW champion, while not one of the best and not really that good at all, it was debatably the most dominant run of Big Show's WWE career. You look at his WWE career, he's been either treated very seriously or completely like a joke. Here's ECW champion. While not that good, he was treated very serious and he was very dominant as ECW champion. However, the big problem with Big Show's reign, it was the lack of competition. I mean, they had no faith in the actual ECW roster, so they had to pluck Raw and SmackDown superstars over to face the Big Show. I mean, yeah, the Ric Flair match was really, really good. I mean, they also brought Undertaker and Kane over. But you had matches like the one with Batista. August 1st, 2006, the match that caused WWE to never run the Hammerstein Ballroom again. If you've never seen the match, watch it. Just watch it, because you'll understand why. I mean, the crowd destroyed that match. Chants throughout the entire match, they destroyed it, and WWE never ran the Hammerstein Ballroom ever again because of it. We're moving along with ECW, and ECW announced that they were going to have their own brand-exclusive pay-per-views. You had Raw pay-per-views, you had SmackDown pay-per-views, and in December, you were going to have an ECW pay-per-view, December to Dismember. Now, the main match in this was the Extreme Elimination Chamber match. Heading into it, they ran the story of Rob Van Dam having to earn his way back to getting a shot at the ECW Championship. He had to defeat the Big Show to get a title shot against him, and Rob Van Dam earned a shot. However, it was later made an Extreme Elimination Chamber match with four other participants. You had qualifying matches, Sabu, CM Punk, and Test qualified, and then Bobby Lashley just showed up and signed the contract to make him the sixth man. Rob Van Dam had to defend his spot against Hardcore Holly, and Rob Van Dam retained it. Now, the other main match on this show was, well, it wasn't an ECW brand match, an ECW brand feud at all. It was a Raw and SmackDown feud of the Hardys and Eminem. Now, when I said the other main match, I meant the only other match, because ECW December to Dismember was advertised with only two matches. Now, with two matches being advertised for a 3-hour pay-per-view, you know each match isn't gonna go 90 minutes. So, we got four bonus unadvertised matches. You had Matt Stryker versus Balls Mahoney in a Stryker's Rules match, which was an extreme enforcement of the rules. No gouging of the eyes, no pulling of the hair, no maneuvers off the top rope, and most importantly, no foul language. Fuck this. You had Elijah Burke and Sylvester Turkai versus the FBI. No thanks. You had Daivari versus Tommy Dreamer. This was a match that happened on pay-per-view that people paid for. And finally, we had Kevin Thorne and Ariel versus Mike Knox and Kelly Kelly, and Ariel was the best part of this match. Main event time, the Extreme Elimination Chamber match for the ECW Championship. Now, one notable thing beforehand, they took Sabu out of the match and replaced him with Hardcore Holly, making it 3-3 on the face-heel spectrum in the match. Now, the fans there and everywhere else wanted one of two people to win this match. You had Rob Van Dam, the established guy trying to get his crown back, and you had CM Punk, the new guy that needs to be established. Now, CM Punk was eliminated first, and then Rob Van Dam was eliminated third. Boos, chance for refunds, etc. The fans, they did not like this. That was being generous. They fucking hated this. Because the match came down to a final three of Big Show, the ECW champion, Test, and Bobby Lashley.
ECW.
You don't like what you like. You like what we tell you you like. And if you don't like it, fuck you. It was so bad. The fans wanted Big Show to win out of spite. And in the end, Bobby Lashley speared Big Show for the three and became the new ECW champion. So what went wrong with ECW December to Dismember? Now, the easier question would be what went right. And the answer is one thing. The Hardys versus Eminem in the opener, it was a really good match, though it went a little too long. Alright, now for the problems. Number one, the fact that this show existed. ECW as a third brand was half of Raw and SmackDown. It only got an hour, and as such, had half the roster. So doing an ECW-branded pay-per-view with the roster they had wasn't the greatest idea. Number two, advertisement. They only advertised two matches, and they expected people to pay full pay-per-view price on the back of only two matches. Now, keep in mind, this was a week after the Survivor Series and 2 weeks before Armageddon, so only advertising two matches was horrible. Number three, the Extreme Elimination Chamber. The booking of this match was really the nail in the coffin of any hope of the new ECW, because by all accounts, either Rob Van Dam or CM Punk were supposed to win this match. And Punk was supposed to make Big Show tap in the first few minutes of this match, and Big Show was fine with this as he was leaving anyways after this. And this was done in the original ECW a time or two, having the world champion lose in the first few minutes of a three-way dance, and Vince said, "Absolutely not," on everything Heyman wanted to do, and it was going to be Bobby Lashley winning this no matter what. Many other problems, but this show existing, the advertising of only two matches, and the booking fail of the Extreme Elimination Chamber caused this show to be a failure. ECW December to Dismember was a complete disaster, and it was a history-making complete disaster. The attendance for the show was 4,800 in the James Brown Arena in Augusta, Georgia. The pay-per-view buys for this show was 90,000 worldwide, with 55,000 domestic here in the United States, which, that 55,000 number, the second lowest domestic pay-per-view total buys in WWE history during the pay-per-view era, which was the Wrestling Classic in 1985 to Elimination Chamber 2014. Now, ironically enough, the Wrestling Classic, that's the lowest domestic WWE pay-per-view buy in history with 47,000. But that was in 1985 when pay-per-view was very, very limited. Now, not long after December to Dismember, Paul Heyman was shown the door. And even though it was Vince's call, Heyman was the scapegoat for everything. According to WWE, it was quote-unquote slumping television ratings and a disgruntled talent roster, which was the reason for Heyman being shown the door, again, according to WWE. Actuality, butting of heads between Vince and Heyman, the Extreme Elimination Chamber being the final straw. Big Show, he was gone after the following episode of ECW, when Lashley defeated him in the rematch. Big Show turned down a seven-figure-a-year contract to give his body a rest, and Show would not return until No Way Out 2008. Brand-exclusive pay-per-views. It was this show that caused the end of brand-exclusive pay-per-views. Sure, Armageddon was already contractually obligated to do, so they did that show 2 weeks later. After Armageddon 2006, there would be no more brand-exclusive pay-per-views until the new brand split in 2016. And ECW would still go on as a third brand until February 2010. Share your thoughts on ECW December to Dismember in the comments section below. Like the video, comment in the comments section below, subscribe if you haven't already, and thanks to those who have already subscribed. Don't forget to vote for From the Vault Episode 8, which will be the first episode of 2018. Until next time, peace.